worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, was suppressed Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Prince, how are the seven links to awakening fulfilled? Once in Savatthi, the blessed Buddha said this, how Ananda and the four foundations of awareness trained and developed so that it fulfilled the seven links to awakening. Whenever Ananda, a bhikkhu, is reflecting upon the body only as an accumulation, not on that very occasion, unconfused and undistracted awareness is established in that bhikkhu. Therefore, on that occasion, the awareness linked to awakening is aroused, and it gradually develops. It reaches a fine fulfillment in that bhikkhu. Dwelling thus aware, he investigates and examines that state by understanding. Whenever Ananda, a bhikkhu, dwells investigating any state, on that occasion the investigation linked to awakening is aroused, and it gradually develops by many repetitions, and it reaches fulfillment in that bhikkhu. When he investigates phenomena using keen intelligence, examines them, his energy is aroused without any slackening. On that occasion, the energy linked to awakening is enlivened, and is gradually developed by many reiterations. He comes to reach fine fulfillment in that bhikkhu when his enthusiastic energy is aroused. There arises in him a rapturous joy. On that occasion, the joy linked to awakening is instigated, and it gradually develops by many renewals. Then it comes to fine fulfillment in that bhikkhu. Both the body and the mind becomes tranquil in whomever is mentally elated by joy. On such occasion, the tranquility linked to awakening is therefore induced, and it gradually develops by maturation. It reaches fulfillment in that bhikkhu. In one whose body is tranquil and who is happy, the mind becomes concentrated. On that occasion, the concentration linked to awakening is self-stimulated, and it gradually develops by training. It reaches fine fulfillment in that bhikkhu. He then just looks on this concentrated mind with imperturbable equanimity. On that occasion, it therefore induces the equanimity link to awakening, and it gradually develops by rehearsal, and it reaches fulfillment in that bhikkhu. It is Ananda when the four foundations of awareness are trained and refined in exactly this very way that they fulfill the seven links to awakening. Four, thus fulfilling seven. Four, thus fulfilling seven. Once in Savatthi, the blessed Buddha said this, how Ananda are the seven links to awakening trained and developed so that it fulfill true wisdom and final release? Is when a bhikkhu Ananda develops the awareness linked to awakening based upon seclusion, dissolution and ceasing, then it matures into release. When he develops the investigation linked to awakening based upon total seclusion, dissolution and ceasing, then it culminates into mental release. When he develops the energy linked to awakening based upon seclusion, dissolution, disgust and ceasing of craving, then it blossoms into release. When he develops the joy linked to awakening based on solitary seclusion, detached disgust and ceasing of craving, then it progresses into release. When he develops the tranquility linked to awakening based upon complete isolation, dissolution and ceasing, then it comes to a climax of final release. When he develops a concentration linked to awakening, while alone and reclusive, undeceived and cooled. Then there's breakthrough to mental release, when he develops the equanimity link to awakening based upon seclusion, dissolution, disgust, and ceasing of all urge. Then it flourishes into release. It is ananda when these seven links to awakening are trained and refined in this very way that they fulfill the courses of true wisdom and final release. Reaching release. Reaching release. Reaching release. The seven links to enlightenment outshines all. The Blessed Buddha once said, supported whence by Himalaya, king of mountains, do the snake beings and nagas grow a body and get strength. When they have grown a body and got strength there, they go to the tiny mountain pools, from there to the lakes, from there to the streams, from there to the great rivers, from there to the sea, and lastly they go to the mighty oceans, where they complete great growth of the body. Just even so, because in friends, anyone supported by morality, fixed in morality, who cultivates the seven links to enlightenment, makes much of them, wins great growth of the right conditions and prerequisite causes of enlightenment. How does a bhikkhu, being so founded in morality, so fixed in morality, cultivate these seven links to enlightenment? How does he make much of them and win great growth of the right conditions and necessary causes of total awakening? Such noble being simply cultivates the link to enlightenment, that is awareness, while based upon seclusion, isolation, detachment, stilling, culminating in self-surrender. Such noble being simply cultivates the link to enlightenment, that is investigation, while based upon solitude, dispassion, ceasing, culminating in relinquishment. Such noble being simply cultivates the link to enlightenment, that is energy, based on seclusion, indifference, cooling, and culminating in elevation. Such noble being simply cultivates the link to enlightenment, that is joy, based on retreat, on disinterestedness, on ending, culminating in renouncing. Such noble being simply cultivates the seven links to enlightenment, that is tranquility, while based on aloofness, on stilling, on stopping, culminating in deliverance. Such noble being simply cultivates the link to enlightenment, that is concentration, based on separation, on release, on silencing, culminating in emancipation. Such noble being simply cultivates the link to enlightenment, that is equanimity, while based on withdrawal, on detachment, on stilling, culminating in utter self-surrender. That is how a noble being, founded in morality, fixed in morality, cultivates the seven links to enlightenment, and by making much of them, wins to greatness of the conditions that causes the effect of enlightenment. Holy Himalaya, Holy Himalaya. Friends, the seven links to the seven wings of awakening. And how, friends, when the four foundations of awareness have been developed, when they have been made much of, do they complete the seven wings to awakening, the seven links to enlightenment? At the time when a friend is living in contemplating the body only as a frame, just as a disgusting form, enthusiastic, clearly conscious, continually aware of it, so as to control all desire an aversion for bodies and forms in this world. At that time, undisrupted awareness is aroused in this friend. At the time when undisrupted awareness is aroused in such friend, at that time the link to awakening, that is awareness, is stirred up in this friend. Later, over a period, such friend develops this link to awakening, that is awareness. And finally, the link to awakening, that is awareness, comes to complete fulfillment of development in this friend. Living thus aware, awake, mindful, such curious and interested friend examines, inquires into, bring this thing forward for investigation by means of insight. At the time, friends, when such a friend living thus aware, mindfully examines, inquires into, and bring all things, phenomena, and even awareness itself forward for investigation by means of insight. At that time, the link to awakening, that is investigation, is stirred up in this friend. Later, over a period, this friend develops a link to awakening, that is investigation. Finally, the link to awakening, that is investigation into phenomena, comes to complete fulfillment of development in this friend. While such friend is thus examining, inquiring into, and bring things and phenomena forward to investigation by means of insight, then enthusiastic and unsluggish energy is stirred up in this friend. At the time, friends, when unsluggish energy is stirred up in a friend who is examining, who inquires into, who brings all things and phenomena forward for investigation by means of insight, at that time, the link to awakening, that is energy, is stirred up in such friend. Later, over a period, such friend develops the link to awakening, that is energy. And finally, the link to awakening to this energy comes to complete fulfillment of development in this keen, eager, enthusiastic and devoted friend. When such a friend has stirred up energy, unsolid joy arises. At the time, friends, when unsolid joy arises in a friend of stirred up energy, at that time to the link to awakening that is joy is stirred up in such a friend. Later, over a period, this friend develops a link to awakening that is joy. And finally, the link to awakening that is joy comes to complete fulfillment of development in this now ever glad and happy friend. The body of one whose mind is in joy, as happy as one can be, is tranquilized. And thought and thinking too is tranquilized. At the time when both a body of a friend whose mind is in joy is tranquilized, and thinking too is all tranquilized. At that time the link to awakening, that is tranquility, is stirred up in such friend. Later, over a period, this friend develops a link to awakening, that is tranquility. And finally, the link to awakening, that is tranquility, comes to complete fulfillment of development in this calm, serene friend. The thought of one whose body is thus tranquil and at ease is concentrated. At the time when thought is concentrated in one whose body is tranquil and at ease, at that time the link to awakening, that is concentration, is stirred up in such friend. Later, over a period, this friend develops a link to awakening that is concentration. And finally, the link to awakening that is concentration comes to complete fulfillment of development in this well-focused, ever undistracted friend. Such noble friend is one who looks on with proper care at the thought concentrated thus. at the time when a friend looks with proper care at the thought concentrated thus, at that time the link to awakening that is equanimity, a solid, even mental balance, is stirred up in such fine friend. Later over a period, this friend develops a link to awakening that is equanimity. And finally, the link to awakening that is equanimity comes to complete fulfillment of development in this friend. When such a friend is faring along, contemplating the feeling just as reactive responses, the mind just as changing moods, and all phenomena just as mental states, enthusiastic, clearly conscious of them, continually aware of them, he will control any desire and any dejection regarding all phenomena in this world. At that time, the link to awakening that is equanimity comes to fulfillment of development in this friend. Friends, the four foundations of awareness, when developed thus, made much of thus, refined thus, brings to fulfillment the seven links to awakening. And how, friends, when the seven links have been developed, how, when they are made much of, do they bring to fulfillment freedom through knowledge? Herein, a friend develops a link to awakening that is awareness, dependent on aloofness, dependent on detachment, dependent on ceasing, ending in relinquishment. The friend develops a link to awakening that is investigation, the link to awakening that is energy, the link to awakening that is joy, the link to awakening that is tranquility, and the link to awakening that is concentration, the link to awakening that is equanimity, dependent upon aloofness, detachment, ceasing, culminating in relinquishment. Friends, when the seven links to awakening are developed thus, are made much of thus, are refined thus, they bring to utter fulfillment freedom through knowledge. Thus spoke the Lord. Delighted, these speakers rejoiced in what the Lord Buddha had said. The seven wings, the seven wings.
Very hello to you, good friends. This is Dhamma on air number 93. Recorded on a windy, fresh day up here on the mountain. Not ideal for sound recording, but nevertheless, a nice day. A nice afternoon, Friday afternoon. Two people from UK has just left the hermitage after a short visit. Today, there are, as usual, three questions, and first some announcements. But first, also, as usual, the normal intro. Namo Tasso Bhagavato Arahato Samma-Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha, indeed. First, off the bat, I like again, as your ticket to Nirvana, to subscribe there. If you're not already subscribed, click the small red button that is on the screen. turn your mobile phone or mobile device horizontally, then you see the red button, click subscribe there. If you already have clicked subscribe, click the small bell under there, so you're being notified about any new video, and click the like button so it is promoted, this video on YouTube, for other of our good and worthy friends. Secondly, there's the two meditation courses I'd like to advertise again. It is from the one here is in June 2018. Start the 17th and ends the 30th June here in Kandy. There will be two visits to Temple of the Tooth and Mahayangana Stupa to offer lotuses to the Buddha's tooth relic and his collarbone relic. And then it'll be a classic meditation course, 10-day course there, covering Buddhist history, 40 meditation objects, 6 in depth, Abhidhamma, the relation between Buddhism and science, and various other subjects. Highly recommendable. It will be repeated in North Carolina, December 2018, from the 20th December to the 1st January 2019. They are both advertised on whatbuddhasaid.net, and there's programs there and additional information. So go to whatbuddhasaid.net and look at this page there, then you see the two meditation courses. Next up is the old Buddha Direct group sending out emails is gone down. Due to some technical issues at Google, I made a new one, but old users should go there and resubscribe. Search for Buddha Direct 2 or see under the video in the description, click more and then see the written description that is under this video or under the audios, and then go click to the Buddha Direct Google Groups forum and resubscribe. Or send me your email, then I will resubscribe you. And my email is bhante.samahita@gmail.com. So far, so good. Question 276. Is working in a fast food hamburger restaurant considered wrong livelihood? Clearly, yes. That is indeed wrong livelihood. Since why? Since right livelihood, the opposite of wrong livelihood, which is a factor of the Noble Eightfold Way, is defined as the following. Fifthfold definition. Earning a living not involving any trading with living beings. Not in an aquarium store for ornamental fish because they have a nice life, but selling pigs for slaughter and birds for slaughter and eggs that should be... and calves and so on that ends up on the, as flesh for consume, that is wrong livelihood. Earning a living not involving any selling of meat, fish or flesh, whether cooked or not, doesn't matter. So any supermarket that sells flesh, any restaurant that sells flesh or fish, wrong livelihood. Why so? Because other beings have given their life for once earning money. And participating in that one becomes directly responsible for that. And this one will have to pay for. What is the payment of wrong livelihood in this regard? If one sells dead beings, the flesh of dead beings, animal beings for example, then usually one will be reborn as the same animals as one has sold the flesh from, in most cases. Not all. If one do compensatory good, one can escape it. So one should, as fast as possible, find a right livelihood as fast as is practically possible, and then transition to a vegetarian diet. 3. Earning a living not involving any selling of any form of weapons, because they're used for killing. Earning a living not involving any dealing with alcohol or drugs. Earning a living not involving any selling of any form of poison. That is right livelihood. So wrong livelihood, since it will result in animal rebirth from 10 to 100,000 times, then it's an important issue. Take it up as soon as practical. Vegetarian diet, I did in the beginning, I cut off first pork, then I cut off beef, then I cut off chicken and other birds, and then at last I cut off fish. And I also cut off milk products and eggs. And then you are scot-free. So this I can recommend, neither of these food items is actually designed for human consumption, nor are they particularly healthy. So transitioning to a vegetarian diet is both healthy and karmically advantageous. The characterization of right livelihood for lay people. Any livelihood that neither involves any killing, injuring, harming, nor any forced imprisoning of any living being. Neither any stealing, taking what is not given, cheating or bribery, corruption or lying or false deceiving tricks, not using false measures or weights, neither sensual nor any sexual abuse. Neither the use or selling of alcohol or any intoxicating illegal drugs that causes carelessness. Neither by oneself nor by getting nor inciting other employed beings to do so. Such is right livelihood. For further study of this Buddhist right livelihood, Samma-Ajivo, I give a link below here on Samma-Ajivo, some small text about it. 2, is the abandonment of all beliefs liberation? No. Deliberate shying all forms of belief, which is impossible actually, because how can one shy? Then one should only stick to what one knows. And that's very difficult because one has views about everything. How gravity is, what's inside the earth, what's on the other side of the moon, what causes the planets to move and so on. Which one cannot, strictly speaking, confirm oneself directly. One can believe what the university guy says, but that's no evidence in the absolute sense. And you cannot learn wisdom, absolute knowledge on university, because non-academic person. No academic person is actually aware of what it is because of lack of the contemplative method. So the absolute knowledge, also called wisdom, is something that one has to cultivate oneself. Usually under circumstances like this, in nature, not disturbed by sex, drugs and rock and roll and society buzz. So agnosticism, which people often seek to, is rather related to ignorance, self-blinding. I say, I won't believe anything, then I believed the wise guys over there at the university level. They say it's not belief, but it is belief anyway. Deliberate agnosticism is basically one doesn't neither believe nor know anything. If it's a deliberate and knowingly, I say, I know nothing. Then it's very advantageous because there's a good starting point to start to come to know something, at least. But if it's shying all religion and all belief, and then think that is less true than what other people say, just because they have an academic degree, that is plain foolishness and folly. Because they have their own agenda. They have their own beliefs that they think is knowledge. But later down the road is not knowledge. And science is always progress in work in progress is never will never finish and never reach an absolute level. What you learn at one science conference, the next year you learn something else. And so it progresses. But it will never become absolute. I think it's rather this not shying all beliefs is rather can be approached to right view. If done rightly, especially in the Buddhist view, then you will come to know what is right view and wrong view. Right view is something that actually looking at some views, some beliefs, something one cannot confirm that actually is correct. So it's right view, but one cannot confirm it this. So one has faith in it, that's right view. That, for example, killing another being is foolish because it shortens one's life length in this life and in the future also, karmically speaking. So this is right view. And giving now will be getting later. That's also right view, an article of right view. But one cannot confirm it by direct experimental evidence oneself before enlightenment. After enlightenment, then one need to have no faith in it. Then one has direct knowledge, anya, in these subtle issues. Because of having the divine eye, seeing a person do this and that, and then later seeing them re-arise as animal or whatever down the road, or as rich person if they've done something good. So that one can make a causal link between action and reaction, between behavior and result of behavior. On the other hand, enlightened beings entertain no beliefs. But you cannot say you can become enlightened by shying all beliefs. You have to pass through right view, which is a factor of the Noble Eightfold Way. Then complete the right view, right view, right view, until one complete the Noble Eightfold Way and become enlightened. Then there's no need to believe anything or trust anything or have faith in anything. Nor is there any need for disbelieving anything, which is also a form of belief. I don't believe this and that. It's religion, it's torture, it's dogmatic, and so on. Well, that's also belief. It is belief of that is false. Belief that is right or false is the same belief. It's just two different judgments. But it's still belief, because one cannot personally verify it or falsify it. And that's the point. So there's no need for the enlightened being neither to believe nor to disbelieve anything whatsoever. Why not? Because they have completed the Noble Eightfold Way, and by actually doing what should be done, and then they are enjoying the fruit of that. And that means that they have assured knowledge, absolute certainty about the issues that ordinary beings are confused about, or have doubt or hesitation, or speculative views about. Maybe they're even confused about it. 3. Why did Gotama Buddha keep the Eastern belief of rebirth, which is a Hindu belief? Rebirth is a scientifically proven fact, has nothing to do with the Hindu belief. All religions, and now also science, which is also a form of religion or knowledge field, at least, now have found out that rebirth is a fact. There's been 60 years of systematic peer-reviewed published research in the object, first of all by Dr. Jan Stevenson, which you see here, now continued by Jim Tucker, which you see here. And there I've talked about it in 3 different videos, and they will come up here and be linked in the description of this video and audio below. And if one is interested in understanding and examining this research more closely, then there's a good book, Return to Life by Jim Tucker. I'll give the links below. Otherwise, one can go to Division of Perceptual Studies, University of Virginia Schools of Medicine, Charlottesville. I give the links below. And I also given a short paper by Jim Tucker, a scientific paper, Children's Reports of Past Life Memories, a review. It's 4 pages. I give it also below. So basically, small children can sometimes, from 2 to 6, can sometimes remember details from their former life, which can be confirmed by going into public archives. And they, for example, how they died and who they were and what they did and what their names were and so on. From person that lived 100 years ago. And how could these kids know that? You know, they have no chance of knowing it, these details. And so this means that there's proof of the pudding, there's proof of these facts that they tell about. There's now 2,500 cases of those. They are usually from 2 to 6, can be up to 10 years, then they forget about it. 80% of those that have died, their so-called reincarnation, they came from, died from violent, sudden, dramatic death at the age of average 20 years old, 28 years old. So they are ripped out of life, and that's why their reincarnation probably can't remember it. But nobody can remember anything after 10, 15 years. You can probably also remember something from your former birth, but you don't identify these flashbacks as memories from your former birth. You just identify as fantasies or inclinations or tendencies or even dreams. But actually it's flashbacks from former rebirth, especially in particular those experiences that's called déjà vu in French, already seen. You come to a place, it seems familiar, you scratch your head, say, have I been here before? And you have been there before. Can be in a former life and it just look widely different now, but you have actually been there before. So déjà vu has a natural explanation. So rebirth, reincarnation is a fact, undeniable fact. Dig that, friends. Huh? Then the whole ball game is new. So because what happens at death, what will happen on the other side of death, then suddenly attain crucial relevance. Whether I will be an ant or a pig or a caged up chicken having to lay eggs for 2 months and then being killed in a machine, cruel machine, or whether I'll be a human being at low social level, middle social level, high social level, or I'll be a shining divine being. That has crucial importance for one's own well-being and welfare in the future. And the whole Buddhist ball game is either to attain a state that is higher than human in the next life or go scot-free. But first of all, prevent downfall to the lower states, the apaya, the fearful states, that is animals, hungry ghosts, angry demons, and hell beings. Because they have more pain, more frustration, more suffering than we have. So no more fooling around with calling rebirth and reincarnation belief. Because there is, and has been published since my birth for the last 60 years, scientific data stacked up, point by point, in peer-reviewed scientific journals, that reincarnation and rebirth is a fact. Period. Huh? No more belief, blah, blah, blah. No need. Examine the case first. It is published, has been published for 60 years. It is self-blinding ignorance and arrogance not to examine a case before one evaluates and prematurely dish out a falsehood like saying that rebirth and reincarnation is a belief, while it is a fact and you're living one of your reincarnations right now. For along the same lines, why did he speak of other Hindu beliefs such as Devas, gods and so? Because he had numerous reported in all detailed conversation with the multitudes of Devas here in the Samyutta Nikaya, which is one of the five texts one has to read three times in one's life, where the two first chapters, roughly 50 pages each, is conversations, accurate reports, detailed reports about conversation he had with various devatas, young female devas, and various devaputtas, young male devas, usually in poetic forms. Why so? Because devas, they know that this conversation will be reported in 5,000 years for human beings, and so they formulate their questions in an exquisite language. They don't say, "Hey, buddy, Buddha buddy, you're coming up for some beers and barbecue tomorrow or what?" They don't. And this is because they have given up this animal-like speech, Tirakana Yoni speech, which is usually entertained by people who have a Tirakana Yoni, means animal womb, future. People claim any group or organization which tells you that what to do and what not to do, which has you withdrawn from society, can be classified as a cult. Is Buddhism a cult? No. Are all religions cults because they all try to control people? No. I don't think actually religions tries to control people It's a common assumption, but I don't try to control anybody, actually. They have to control themselves. I have big problems with controlling myself, so I assume they also have. And so self-control actually is a fairly difficult thing. It's even more difficult to control others. I say it's in principle impossible, actually. I think religions more should be considered as free consultants, free coaching, free doctoring, free security, and free protection. To the extent one are able to critically thinking and independently verifying, insist on personal direct experience, but taking advice from other people that has been in the same situation as oneself, seeking but not knowing where and what to find, not knowing where one comes from before death, not knowing where one is going after death, not knowing which causes brought you for where one comes from, and neither, unfortunately, knowing which causes now brings to whatever rebirth down the lane next. So it's like a large room, and there's a lot of people inside this room, and there is a curtain. And all these beings in this large room, they ask themselves, what is behind that curtain called death? This you cannot be taught about in university. I know, because I went to university and completed a doctoral degree. So they couldn't tell me, and nobody else can tell you, than those that come from other knowledge field than the scientifically minded. But science has now happily also examined this and published about it. Please examine it. The links is below in this video and in this audio. Question 277. A stream intra, a sotapanna, doesn't believe or cling in rule and ritual, but isn't going to the temple of the tooth relic and do offer also a ritual. Yet, yes, you can say it is a ritual. Actually, I don't do it as a ritual, but because many do it, then it becomes a ritual. But this doesn't entail clinging to it. This means if I had to go to Denmark tomorrow or to another country because of political instability in this country, well, then I won't cry or cling because I cannot come to Kandy and offer to the tooth really. So I'm not clinging to it. Under rule, clinging to rule and rituals, silabata paramasa will be something like saying and insisting tenaciously, clinging to this thing, rituals alone purify mind and can produce enlightenment. So if this believing that this is the whole way, occasional rituals, participating in occasional rituals, whether you enjoy it or not, can be in other people's rituals. I am invited for dhanas. They are very ritualistic here, where there's a whole schedule about how things is done, and the food is served for the monks, and then that's a whole special way of doing it. So it's ritualistic. But since I don't particularly enjoy going to these rituals, which usually takes 4 or 5 hours, then I don't cling to it. And neither do I cling, actually, to going to the Temple of the Tooth. But I enjoy it, I would say, because I think it's the right thing to do. And since I am a place where there's a unique chance, and this also will go for the meditators who comes here in June, a unique chance for offering to the Lord Buddha's relics, which has this individual address, quantum mechanical address, of a humongous probability that wouldn't be the same thing if I give to a dog a bone or to a bone from another human, but would be if I could find another enlightened being, another enlightened monk. It will be at the same time still large, but not as large as Samma-Ajivo. And that's an important thing. It's true, the Buddha is not alive yet, but his relic still contains the address, the quantum mechanical address, the quantum mechanical individuality When two particles become entangled in quantum mechanics, then they are not entangled to other particles. They can't be like a be entanglement swapping out, but it's an individual address. So this, when you do something to this, then something happens to that also. Despite however far you separate them in space and time. So this individuality is preserved, as Bohr called it, individuality. And this is still connected with this truth that lies inside Kandy. And therefore it is value, it gives an enormous boost, karmic boost and lift to offer to such genuine relics as it is in this case. While offering to any bone or to any other tooth doesn't contain this. It basically has nothing to do with the teeth itself, it has to do with the address it contains. And same thing with atoms or photons that are entangled in quantum mechanical experiments and has this, when you do something to one of them, then the other one will react also. And same thing with you do something to the tooth, then something will happen to yourself and your future also. This is basically a conditional relation. Has nothing to do with the particles with themselves. Because if you measure two pairs and they are entangled, one pair and B, in pair entangled B also, then one of them from each pair can become entangled. And then the original entanglement into the two pairs is lost. This is called entanglement swapping. So it's not connected with the particle, the matter, the mass itself, nor the truth itself. It's the address, the conditional relation, the causal node in the cause and effect network is that which matters, which has effects. So, if one tenaciously claims rituals alone is enough to purify mind and produce enlightenment, then one is clinging to rules and rituals. And this is the first mental hindrance of Thera Samyojana, abrogating access to stream entry. True, but I don't ascribe to that at all, at all. It cannot, you can go to and offer to Lord Buddha's truth as many times as you want. It will never make you noble. Never. It can help you do the meditation, do the reflection inside work, and make the path much easier. But one has to do the work oneself. There's no free lunch, neither by offering to the Lord Buddha's tooth. It can make the path easier, but one still has to walk the path and travel the path, do the right things, get right view, complete the Noble Eightfold Way to 25% degree, and then get this phase transition of consciousness that is irreversible, and thereby cutting off rebirth to the lower stages of animal rebirth, hungry ghost rebirth, angry demon rebirth, and hell being, which screams for centuries and millennia without end in the Avicii hell, which is the lowest. Question 278, which is the last. If the Buddha were asked by Ananda three times to live longer, he could have lived longer. He actually, Ananda only had to ask him one time to live longer, but Ananda failed to do that. Why didn't he do that? And why did he have to experience this bodily illness by eating something that caused him to have diarrhea? So age, sickness and death are not eliminated by entering Nibbana, and even a Samma-Sambuddha has to endure aging, sickness and death. All beings, including enlightened beings, has to endure aging, sickness and death. However, enlightened beings only have to endure it once. While Puttuyanas, ordinary beings, have ahead of them a principally endless, infinite row of repeat of aging, sickness, death, rebirth, aging, sickness, death, rebirth, aging, sickness, death. An infinite row, in principle. While Samasam Buddhas and Arahats, other awakened beings, only have to do it once. So if you fear death and aging and sickness is unpleasant to you, well, then consider this endless row that are in front of you. If you can dig the fact of rebirth first, of course. That's necessary. So, why did the Buddha choose this diarrhea way of dying? He chose it. We've been discussing it first. I think it's the closest statement he could come to vegetarianism, to be pro-vegetarian. He was asked whether by his evil cousin Devadatta, as one of 10 things not to change to, because Devadatta wants to take over the Sangha, and he know this vegetarianism was very popular with lay Buddhists. So he requested the Buddha to change that. But the Buddha said no. And I think he said no because the fifth precept says that you cannot drink alcohol. And 90% of human population, if not more, are very attached to drinking alcohol and also smoking marijuana and taking other kinds of drugs. So this means that 90% cannot be good Buddhists. They can be only 80% Buddhist while still drugging and drinking. If he also said, ah, now you should be vegetarian, then he will cut out more than 95% of the rest of them. And this means cutting out basically 99 out of 100, 99% of all beings could not be good Buddhist by only two rules. And since you can't be a good Buddhist by eating meat, you just have to avoid killing. That's and harming by any means. Then dead meat is the same as a rotten log lying in the forest or this tree that is unconscious. And if my body dies and drop dead here in the front of the camera, then you're free to eat it. I don't need it anymore. And I won't suffer when you cook it or eat it. So please go ahead. So this means that there's no, one cannot be blamed for eating dead meat, because this dead meat is not connected with consciousness anymore. It is the killing of it and the suffering of the being before it is killed that is blamable. But what happens after to the flesh is kind of like neutral. I hope this answered the questions. The question about the hamburger restaurant and selling meat and flesh, this is because it keeps up this perpetual, and I think also this goes for a modern day cruel and I think humiliating and terrible way of producing milk and eggs, in particular elk eggs. These chickens that lives under this with no feathers in these small cages and produce eggs and then are killed after some months. This is terrible. So I think one should avoid all meat, eggs and milk, because it's not healthy anyway. Because one will help other beings indirectly. The crucial issue is there that one is earning a living by it. One is earning a living by it, by selling somebody who has been killed. And it's keeping up this butchery business, which is a multi-billion dollar business. And it doesn't matter whether it's a five-star Michelin restaurant, or it's a hamburger restaurant, or it's a supermarket, or whatever. Same thing. Any supermarket also sell insect poisons. Some supermarkets, even in USA, sell weapons. And this is, of course, also wrong livelihood. And because one earns a living on it, then one becomes responsible for it. But if somebody serves it for you, you are not responsible for it, because you didn't ask it for it. And that's why it's legal for monks and also for lay Buddhists, I would say, and blameless to accept non-vegetarian food if it's not seen, not heard, and not suspected that the meat, the flesh was killed particularly for your sake. If it is seen, heard, or suspected that it's killed particularly for your sake, for your personal sake, then one should avoid eating it. And so it's also not allowable for monks to eat. I hope this clears these issues. Again, right livelihood, not involving and living, earning money by selling live beings, slaves, prostitutes, children for pedophilia, chickens for slaughter, pigs for slaughter, or upbringing and then slaughter, calves for slaughter, like that. Not earning a living selling dead flesh, fish or meat, whether cooked or uncooked. Not earning a living selling any form of weapons used to kill, taking life, thereby you lose life yourself. Not earning a living selling any form of poison, you'll be poisoned yourself as a karmic effect and die from poisoning. Various kinds of environmental poisoning, lead poisoning, food poisoning, whatever. Not earning a living selling any form of alcohol or illegal drugs, because they make other beings harm each other. Recently there was someone here who told me that her husband, the son of her father, has killed himself by drinking. Basically drinking until they die. Take something like half a year, a year, 2 years, depending on how much you drink. Very common. Can be seen all over the world. Very, very common. Thank you for your attention, contribution, and patience. Thank you also for being a good Buddhist friend by subscribing, clicking the bell, and clicking the like button. And may you have indeed a nice and noble day by remembering silence is bliss. 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 Namo tassu bhagavato arahato Samma-Sambuddhassa, worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, was the Blessed Buddha. Indeed, yeah. So be it.
You heard. Bhikkhu Samma-Ajivo from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Bambarella, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy. Thereby, thank you. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato Samma-Sambuddhassa, worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, was the Blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution. And have a nice day.